morning. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. A beautiful spring morning. Today is Palm Passion Sunday. It's the beginning of Holy Week. This afternoon, the Ministerial Association will have their Sunday afternoon Lenten service. It'll be at Argenta Baptist Church at 4 o'clock this afternoon. Tuesday, there will be a blood drive here from 1 until 6. Important life-giving ministry that we have here at our church. So if you're able to give, please do. Next Friday, Good Friday, there will be the Ministerial Association will have a Good Friday service. It will be at Argenta Christian Church. There will be a potluck at 6, followed by the service at 7 o'clock in the evening. So, any other announcements? Anything that needs to be lifted up? Marla.
We were supposed to do the AO support lunches on Friday, and the game got canceled. So we have a basket of bananas that need to be, just grab you a couple on the way out and take them home.
Bananas, huh? All right. Todd. It's going to be downtown?
Yes.
Yeah, there. Okay.
They've got people from all over bringing in antique tractors and stuff.
All right.
I told my dad.
I think the answer to that is probably yes. As long as they leave one or two of the tractors for us to play with during the week.
There you go.
All right. Sounds good. Any other announcements? Anything? All right, my friends, would you please stand as you are able and join with me in our open, yep, one more.
What did we decide about next Sunday morning for breakfast?
Ah, thank you. All right, one more announcement. Next Sunday morning, we will have a sunrise service at 7 o'clock. It probably won't be sunrise at that point. It'll already be up, but you get the idea. Early morning worship service on Easter, 7 o'clock, followed by a breakfast, and then we will not have our regular 10:30 service. We'll just have one service, okay? I know some folks are going to be traveling and being with family in other parts of the state and country. So anyway, I hope that works for everybody. All right, very good. Thank you, Marla. Would you please stand as you were able and join with me in our opening hymn, All Glory, Laud, and Honor, number 280.
Thank you. You may be seated. The call to worship. Awake to the day of triumph for our Savior. Give thanks for this day that leads to the cross. Come with your branches, hosannas, and songs. Fill the air with welcome to the Lord. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Holy God, you reveal the truth about your people and the ways of our world in the suffering of the Son and his steadfast love. Show us again the image of humility you desire for us, and teach us obedience so that self-emptying may be our pathway. Through Christ Jesus, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Let us face this day of palms and Jesus' passion with honesty, confessing our own sin before our Lord God. Would you please join with me in our prayer of confession? Holy God, sure of your faithfulness even in your dying, comforted by your compassion toward your people in every age, we beg your mercy for our imperfect gratitude. We have looked to you for paltry favors when you have given everything. We have withheld from your people, our neighbors, and from your creation the care and tending they deserve. We have rejected the cornerstone you sent to build a people of righteousness even here today. Forgive our failings. Heal what we have broken. Nurture what we have neglected, and lead us to your vision so that we may know the peace of wholeness in you, in Jesus' name. Amen. My friends, your Lord has come to you, humble in the form of a slave, to free you from the weight of sin and death. Jesus' obedient suffering has released you. Your sins are forgiven. In the name of the one who is exalted beyond what we can comprehend, Christ Jesus, our Savior and our Lord. Praise be his holy name.
Let our hosannas to the one who brings liberation take form in our offering. Please stand for the doxology. God of all good gifts, we thank you for showing us how to care for each other. May these gifts lead to great feasting for those who have no banquet set before them. May these gifts build shelters and places of prayer for those who are homeless. May these gifts proclaim your desire that all your creation live in peace. Give us grateful hearts, O Lord. In the name of the one who came to draw all people to himself, Christ Jesus, our Savior. Amen. You may be seated.
This is our time of joy and concern. Have any joy today? Beautiful day.
called me in Sunday school this morning, and something's going on with Rachel's leg. He's going to have to take her to the ER. I don't know any more than that, so let's keep Rachel in our prayers.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers.
We might continue keeping Betty Jordan in our prayers.
Betty is at the hospital having some fairly serious issues. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Pastor Bobby?
Yes.
I'd like you to keep Little Rock in your prayers. Little Rock was devastated by this last tornado, and they've already had 39 people dead. It also, keep my granddaughter and her family in your prayers. A tornado went right down their street. And she's okay, the house is okay, except for her fence. And they lost their brand new trampoline, which Elowen is very upset about. So it's just devastation there. And I think we should just keep all the tornado victims in our prayers, because there's so many even here in Illinois.
The Lord in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
You know, I kind of ended up the same thing. God's creation seems to be changing. You know, it has been in the past kind of a political issue about climate change, but I think the evidence is becoming more and more in front of us, and the harshness of the storms, the things that have happened on the West Coast and the East Coast, something is happening that's more severe than the past. So let's pray for God's creation, and that we, those who are stewards of this creation, that we can just be in harmony with God and that creation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Tammy, would you like to hear me for a little while? Okay. All right. All right. All right. And we will pray the Lord's prayer. You know, for everyone has. Okay. Let's shout it out. You can do it. It's okay. All right. I'm glad you're here. We enjoy having a young person here with us and helping us. He wasn't when he was waving at your palm. You were quite okay with that, weren't you? Yeah. All right. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Bless this young man.
The prayer of illumination. O Lord, let your word break open our hearts this day through the power of your Holy Spirit, so that we may enter into the coming Holy Week with the same mind that was in Christ Jesus. Amen. The New Testament reading is from Philippians 2, 5 through 11. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he had himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Our first hymn sing is Tell Me the Stories of Jesus, number 277.
number 160.
Marching right along, weren't we? Our gospel reading this morning is from Matthew chapter 21, verses 1 through 11. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethpage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet, "Say to daughter Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the ground. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." This is a beautiful story. Jesus is coming into the city. There's a parade. There is excitement. There is passion. Wow, I can just kind of visualize it. What a neat scene that would be. Positive, exciting. You know, parades have a way of being a great fun, don't they? In Decatur, we do lots of parades there. There's a parade for just about every situation. And I think there's lots of parades that we have out here at Argenta too, don't we? There's quite a number. It's a time to get together to celebrate and just see something exciting, nearly always honoring something or someone You know, from time to time we go downtown and stand for hours on a sidewalk with hundreds of other people in hope of seeing someone who's the focus, that team, or maybe it might be Santa. Who knows? We're going to have something pretty neat at the end. We arrive early, and still there's some who got there even earlier. Can you imagine how many hours some people wait in line to have that perfect view, to get that candy that's thrown outside or whatever, you know? And finally, the parade goes by, and there's this dignitary. Neat and exciting. And then it's over. Anyway, today is Palm Sunday, and the hero of our parade today is Jesus. Jesus is having made his reputation out in the backcountry. You know, the hinterland has quite a little following. His reputation is ahead of him, and finally he's made it to the capital city, and everybody wants to get a glimpse of this person we've all talked about. Matthew says that one question that was on the lips of the people of the city was, "Who is this? Who is this?" The crowd was quick to come to its own conclusions. In the very next verse, an answer is given to their question. The crowds were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus from the city of Nazareth in Galilee." There you are. Jesus is not primarily a wonder worker of miracles, a successful physician, a rabbi who knows the Bible backwards and forwards. Jesus is a prophet, a speaker of the truth of God. I expect that there are at least two reactions to him. In the crowd that day, as Jesus passed by and everyone hailed him as a prophet, if you were one of the common people, you know, ordinary folks, you might have been pleased, even excited. The prophets of God invariably spoke for the voiceless, the people on the bottom of the pile, naming injustice for what it is called, the rich and the powerful to account on the basis of God's holy law. If you happen to be rich and powerful, on the other hand, you would have viewed Jesus' entry into Jerusalem with more than a little bit of concern. Prophets in Israel were notoriously tough on politicians, lawyers, bankers, the idle rich, the smug and powerful. Get ready for trouble, because here comes a prophet, and he's got something to say about you. Prophecy had died out in Israel by the first century AD, or before Christ. Speakers of the truth had been in short supply for hundreds of years. John the Baptist, Jesus' cousin, was hailed by his followers as a modern prophet. Herod the king took one look at John, listened in on one of his sermons in which he spoke of the business community and the clergy as a brood of vipers. That's harsh. You know that? A brood of vipers, snakes. Wow. And promptly murdered John. You know, that's what happens when you speak too truthfully and harshly. Prophets and the powerful have never liked one another. That's the truth. Speakers of truth are always in short supply. No wonder a great crowd had come out to greet this new prophet. It's always easier for a preacher to go with the flow, to pamper and flatter the congregation rather than to tell them the truth. I hope this doesn't show on me, but, you know, we clergy have that way. After all, we're in this community. We live here too. You know, we're a part of this. That, and I can tell you in all honesty, we learn to love you guys and gals. And when you do, sometimes, well, you get the idea. You don't want to rock the boat. So, there was a survey that said that over 200 Southern Baptist preachers are fired every month. M-O-N-T-H, every month. The Baptists are the largest congregation in our nation. Still, there's a large number of prophets who are out of work. How about that? Speakers of truth are always in short supply. No wonder a great crowd had come out to greet this new prophet. It's always easier for a preacher to go with the flow. Let's see, here we go. So, the crowd asked this question, who is this? Oh, a prophet. Now things are going to heat up in this old town. There's a prophet among us, and his name is Jesus. Having a prophet's not enough. Speaking the truth is one thing. Doing the truth, well, that's quite another thing, isn't it? You know? Come to church and a preacher preaches what's right. You know, you ought to do this, you ought to do that, you should, you must. Heard all that stuff. My wife and I have this little cute thing about being should on. Am I shooting on you, telling you, you know, you should do this, you should do that? Some places the clergy does that all the time, trying to help you to know what God wants you to do, what you should do. How does that work for you guys out there anyway? If I started shooting on you, would you respond to that? Probably not in a positive way, unless I miss my guess. So knowing what to do and doing it are two different things, aren't they? St. Paul complained about this in his letter to the Romans. I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. Now, if I do what I do not want, I agree that the law is good. But in fact, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells within me, that is, in my flesh. I can will what is right, but I cannot do it. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want to do is what I do. Now if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. Doesn't that almost sound like circular logic through there? But you know, it's hard to will ourselves to be good. I've tried. Not very successfully. I suspect most of you have too. That's why that Spirit of the Living God, what we call the Holy Spirit, is so important to us, because that Spirit works within us to help us to become the person that God calls us to be. Anyway, subject for another Sunday. Something more than a prophet and prophecy is needed. This is what Matthew tells us. Jesus not only spoke the truth prophetically, our claim is that Jesus is the truth. He did not just talk about God, he is God. In him, and in this sometimes comforting, often abrasive Jew from Nazareth, we claim that we have seen as much of God as we ever hope to see. Wrap yourself around that a little bit. The teachings of Jesus, this person that looked like us, only, you know, different, but in human form 2,000 years ago, taught us about the kingdom of God and gave us stories about how to live as citizens of the kingdom of God, and then he invited us to follow him, you know? That is as much of God as we are able to grasp. It's a mystery. But we have seen in Jesus what a citizen of the kingdom of God is like. He sets an example for us. So, there is something to cheer about. Jerusalem came to the parade thinking that they had a prophet, a great spokesman for God. And before the parade ended, many saw God. That's why you're here. Even if you didn't recognize, that's why you're here. You have somehow seen God. You need God. You don't need more good advice, any more challenging words, scolding, berating, moralizing. You don't need any of that. What you need is God. And that's why you want to see and stand on tiptoes, hoping to get a glimpse of the Master. How about the thank you, Jesus? Thank you, Jesus. You know, he gave us this sacred meal that we call communion or Holy Communion. And I'm just, especially as I get older, I am struck that there have been generation after generation after generation of diverse people of all kinds of nationalities, of all different skin colors, of all different languages, that have found somehow in the presence of this sacred meal the Lord of life. Some believe that somehow in these elements that Christ is literally present. I know from my own experience that somehow his spirit is present. I can tell that whenever people come forward and I see in their eyes their spirit, the Lord is present. And so today we are going to participate again in a holy meal. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, brought us to a land flowing with milk and honey, and set before us the way of life. And so with your people on earth, and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Christ Jesus. By the baptism of his suffering, death and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. By your great mercy, we have been born anew to a living hope through the resurrection of your Son from the dead, and to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading. Once we were no people, but now we are your people, declaring your wonderful deeds in Christ, who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, the Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. For this is the blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Christ Jesus, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ and one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in his final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Would you please join with me in the prayer that Christ Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one loaf. The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. And the cup over which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. As is our tradition, I would invite you all to come down through the center aisle to receive a piece of the bread from me and to dip your bread in the grape juice. I'd invite you also to spend a moment at this communion rail to give thanks to the Lord your God. Something kind of unique. We have two children in our group.
precious friendship. Would you please join with me in prayer? Loving God, we thank you that you have fed us in this sacrament, united us with Christ, and given us a foretaste of the heavenly banquet in your eternal kingdom. Send us out in the power of your Holy Spirit to live and to work to your praise and to your glory. In the name of Christ Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. My friends, our closing hymn is Great is Thy Faithfulness, number 140.
It's 276. 276
in the Presbyterian?
No.
Yes.
Oh, yep, never mind. Sorry. Wrong one.
Sorry. Got it? All right. Would you please stand, number one?